All right, let's go to the clip where you show what is happening in the cell and how it's programmed with this code.
How do you explain the origin of the Cambrian animal seemingly out of nowhere? This isn't just a problem of explaining the absence of evidence in the fossil record. It's also a problem of explaining everything we know about life right down to the level of molecules and cells.
The biological structure of a Cambrian trilobite was as complex and sophisticated as a modern crab. Its organs included a brain, gut, heart, and compound eyes. Each organ was constructed from specific types of cells. Each cell type was made from dozens of specialized protein molecules. And each protein was assembled from a four-letter chemical code in a section of DNA called a gene.
Now, for the evolutionary process to transform a simple Precambrian organism like a sponge with four or five cell types into a Cambrian trilobite with at least 10 times that many different types of cells, that's a huge leap in complexity. And to make that leap, you need a vast amount of new genetic information. Where does that information come from? That's the central mystery of the Cambrian explosion.
So, Dr. Meyer, help us understand this. Go back to this thing now of chance. I think Murray Eden at Worcester Institute called a conference in the 1960s, and he was a mathematician, and he called evolutionary biologists, and he had people that were working on the atomic bomb. He had all kinds of scientists there, and he had a question that was bugging him. What was it?
Well, Murray Eden was a computer scientist at MIT, and there was a picnic in 1965 where the computer scientists and the physicists and the mathematicians and the engineers were talking with their biology colleagues over lunch. And all these scientists with mathematical training were expressing skepticism about the creative power of the mutation selection mechanism. They didn't believe that it could generate new genetic information on the scale that was required to explain things like the Cambrian explosion. And their main reason for thinking that was they realized that random changes in any formal language system will inevitably degrade meaning. And that is because there's a lot more ways to go wrong than there are to go right. If anyone's played Scrabble and you have a pile of letters, you know that if you just reach in and start picking the letters out at random, you're overwhelmingly more likely to get gibberish than you are to get a word. And that's actually because people have worked out the math on this. The ratio of functional words for any given length to the ratio of sequences of characters that give you gibberish is really minuscule. It's in the case of a 12-letter word, I think the ratio is 1 over 100 trillion. One word for every 100 trillion arrangements of characters that give you nothing but gibberish. So if you start with a word, or start with a section of functional genetic text or a section of computer code, and you start randomly changing it, you're overwhelmingly more likely to end up with gibberish because most of the sequences are gibberish. And that's the problem that the engineers were concerned about at Wistar. And so this is just not a good way to think about how genetic information originated. This mechanism simply is unlikely to produce anything good in the time we have available.
Or as Murray Eden says, it's improbable. It probably couldn't happen.
It's improbable on a cosmic scale. Yeah.